Welcome, choristers. Maybe I'll use the microphone that's here and we'll work that out.
One, two. This one's on. Well, welcome. Merry Christmas. It's good to be here together and to sing some carols together. Now, for a moment, I want you to imagine that it's snowing, a little bit of rain coming down, I think, as we were driving in. But you have to imagine that it's snowing. It is dark, midwinter in Europe. Here we have to perhaps use a bit of imagination at this time of year to think about snow and how it would be like that. But in that cold and dark, how was it that people kept themselves positive and occupied and warm? In many places, they did that by singing and dancing. There we have the origins of what we sing and celebrate as Christmas carols. So for our first hour, at least tonight, this should be a time of dancing as well as singing. Feel free, if you feel so moved, to let your feet free. In the earliest times of the church, Christmas was not celebrated. Jesus' birthday was not celebrated. Some early writers were actually very scathing about celebrating anyone's birthday at all, instead suggesting that what we should be celebrating is their birth into heaven, the date of a person's death. In the early 3rd century, a North African called Sextus Julius Africanus wrote the first account of a Christian history. There he suggested the date of 25th of December for Jesus' birth, even though it didn't fit with the information in the gospel accounts. He suggested that, it seems, as a way of taking over a pagan Roman celebration of the birth of the invincible son, and the date stuck. But still, it seems there were no carols and no records of music because there were no Christmas services at that time. By the time of Constantine, a century later, when his mother Monica went into the Holy Land, there was much more interest in celebrating Jesus' birth, and the first church was built in Bethlehem, as well as churches built in many other places. The earliest celebration of Christmas that we have recorded was in 336. The oldest Christmas song that we have was written just a few years afterwards, by a Frenchman, Hilary of Poitiers. That song, Jesus Refulsit Omnium, Jesus the Brilliance of All, is not one that we usually sing. It hasn't got an English translation, and so unless you really want to sing in Latin, then we probably won't have that one this year, or maybe not for a while. The first carol that we are going to sing is some which some people do know in Latin, or at least the opening words, Adeste Fideles, O come all ye faithful. If, like me, you grew up with a Bing Crosby record playing endlessly at this time of year, those Latin words will ring in your ears. We don't know for sure when it was first written. As we have it, this carol was put together by many hands over many years, reaching its familiar form less than 200 years ago. The words and the tune as we have them are attributed to John Francis Wade and were put together in the middle of the 19th century. Let's join in singing our first carol, O Come All Ye Faithful.
Thank you. Please be seated between the carols. I said that the oldest Christmas carol was written in the middle of the 4th century. The next oldest followed soon after in the late 4th or early 5th century. This one choirs do sing. In Latin it is Corde natus ex parentis, born of the heart of the parents. It's usually sung in English as Of the Father's love begotten, and so on. Aurelius Prudentius Clemens wrote that in what is modern-day Spain. All those early writers seem to have three names. It just seemed to go with the times. After that, there is a big gap in the record of Christmas songs. There probably were other Christmas songs written and sung. We just don't know what they were. The next surviving Christmas song, though, is the first of what we would really call carols. But I'll come back to that after we sing again. Our next carol, though, is an example of a modern song, because people, ever since the 4th century, have still been writing Christmas carols, Christmas songs. Writers are still finding ways to express the meaning and joy and celebration of this wonderful event. Sometimes the modern versions that people sing, and you've probably been bombarded with in shopping centres over the last month, are completely cut off from the original events. This one, though, picks up the modern desire to understand what is happening in people who have transforming experiences. This message of Jesus' birth delivered to the shepherds came from the sky, yet it grounded them more deeply on earth and in reality. The thought-provoking words encourage us to recognize how Jesus being born into our world connects us to everything around us, invites us to feel more grounded, and stirs us to discover deep meaning. Now, the tune may be unfamiliar, so I'll ask Peter to play it all the way through before we then sing Beneath a Dark Familiar Sky. Thank you. Please be seated again. St. Francis of Assisi lived in the late 12th and early 13th centuries. And we have Francis to thank for many of the things that we do and celebrate and see at Christmas. We have Francis to thank for nativity scenes. He was the first to create that scene with all of its characters, human and animal. If you read through the accounts that we have in the Bible, you notice that the familiar animals in the nativity scene are not mentioned in the Bible. Francis brought them in, and his first nativity scene had all live animals. He did it outside. Perhaps we'll do that next year, along with more dancing. The third oldest recorded Christmas song, our first real Christmas carol, is from the time of Francis. Originally, it seems, in French. It's sung still in some places with the title The Friendly Beasts. It picks up the themes that Francis showed and then celebrated, the animals and the birds gathering to celebrate Jesus' birth. There are other examples of carols from around the same time, focusing on the animals which were thought to be there to witness Jesus' birth. Remember when I asked you to think about snow and singing and dancing to get warm? Francis and his earliest monks began our tradition of Christmas carols. They would hold hands in circles and dance and sing, using well-known tunes and singing words about Jesus being born. Christmas caroling really began there in the late 13th century in central Italy. Our next carol is a traditional one, but from England, known as the Sussex Carol. The earliest known version, words and music, were published in 684 by Luke Wadding, who was an Irish bishop. He published them in a little booklet that was titled A Small Garland of Pious and Godly Songs. From that title, I suggest there wasn't much expectation of dancing attached to that. Though it does have a great upbeat tune, so maybe try not to keep your feet still. Let's stand and join in singing On Christmas Night, All Christians Sing. please be seated. We do have a number of carols which have survived from the 13th and 14th centuries, although usually they're sung by choirs. If you, like me, have been listening to classic FM during this last week, then you would have had a whole succession of different carols sung from different choirs from all around the world. Most of those carols that we know and sing in our services, though, come from the 19th century or later. Cecil Frances Alexander was a prolific writer of hymns. She wrote All Things Bright and Beautiful, and she also wrote our next hymn, Once in Royal David City. Christmas carols, like nativity scenes and other things we may say and sing and see at this time, have added significantly to what we think of as happening in the Christmas story. For example, if I ask you how many magi, usually called wise men, there were, most people usually say three. Yet the account in Matthew's Gospel doesn't tell us how many there were. It doesn't even say that they were male. But it does mention three gifts, which is why we usually make it three. In the first verse of our next carol, we're told that Jesus was born in a lowly cattle shed. Yet it is far more likely that the place animals were kept and what would have been offered to weary travellers with nowhere else to stay was a cave with some sort of basic fence to keep the animals in, but still mostly open to the elements. The stable gets a mention in the last verse as well, along with oxen, and we have St. Francis to thank for them. Does it matter that all these details have been added in? Perhaps not, so long as we don't start thinking that those added details are essential. They are there to help us to grasp the story, but also to lead us deeper into the wonder of this event. Jesus, God born among us in vulnerability. If those extra details engage our imagination and our wonder, then they serve a good purpose. Now, though, let's stand and join in singing Once in Royal David City. Please be seated. Most of those who wrote Christmas carols, the ones that we sing, had never actually been to the places that they were describing in the carols. St. Francis did go to the Holy Land, and perhaps those early songs that the Franciscan monks sang as they danced were inspired by his visit there. In the late 19th century, an Episcopalian priest, an American Anglican, took what we would now call long service leave. He visited many places, including the Holy Land, including Bethlehem, David's city about which we just sang. Bethlehem was not really peaceful then. It rarely has been a place without problems. It is a place even today where threats of violence from the powerful hang over the vulnerable. Phillips Brooks, that priest, would have seen that there in his visit. And yet he also saw the invitation and the challenge to see more, to really see Bethlehem and the invitation there. The invitation is to be confronted by this birth in Bethlehem in ways which overturn our expectations, which touch our hearts, which call us and draw us closer into relationship with a deep desire for peace. The best Christmas carols are not just froth and bubbles. They are profound invitations deeper into this event. So let's stand again and sing, O Little Town of Bethlehem.
Thank you.
Please be seated. In the readings that we hear preparing for this day, or that we've read all the way through the last month, and at Christmas services, there are lots of titles which are tossed around about Jesus. The Root of Jesse, the Prince of Peace, Emmanuel. Timothy Dudley Smith, a retired English bishop, who's still around, last time I was able to find out, at 96, has, like Mrs. Alexander, written over 400 hymns. In this modern hymn, which may be new to many of you, he picks up lots of those traditional titles of Jesus. Like the extra details added to the story, the animals and other pieces of tradition, the titles given to Jesus have meaning if they help us to engage, to invite us to think deeper. Lots of carols focus just on that moment, on the event. A little while later we'll sing Silent Night. They focus just on the child. This carol is a reminder that the child grew into a man who spoke into our world with hope, that people then and ever since would listen and respond. The tune for these perhaps unfamiliar words should be familiar in itself. It was written in the 20th century by John Wilson and has been used for many hymns. The title for the tune is Lords, which means praise. Let's stand and sing together, See to Us a Child is Born. Please be seated. Singing of Christmas carols, as we sing them, as I've said, began really in the 12th century. Yet it really took off in the 19th century. Many writers then, in that time, searched for older texts, some written in Latin or in other languages, to add to the ever-expanding collection of carols. Our final carol for this part of our service, before the rest of what we're doing begins, comes from Poland and was written perhaps in the 13th century. But in the early 20th century, it was translated into English and made accessible for us. All of the themes that I've noted as I've been thinking about carols are found in this carol, an ancient text set for a modern world, including the animals to set the scene. And in all that is sung, the invitation rings to hear and to be transformed by the birth of Jesus, born for you and me and all of us. Let's stand and sing together, Infant Holy.
Thank you.
Please be seated just for a few minutes and then the service proper will begin. Please stand to join in singing "Hark, the Herald Angels Sing."
Thank you.
grace of the Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all. I bring you good news of great joy for all people. To you is born this day in the city of David a Saviour, Christ the Lord. We pray together, Almighty God, to whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hidden, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name. Through Christ our Lord. Amen.
Christ, the grace of God has dawned upon the world with healing for all. Let us bring our weaknesses and infirmities to him, confessing our sins in penitence and faith. Merciful God, our Maker and our Judge, we have sinned against you in thought, word and deed, and in what we have failed to do. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbours as ourselves. We repent and are sorry for all our sins. Father, forgive us. Strengthen us to love and obey you in newness of life. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Almighty God, who has promised forgiveness to all who turn to him in faith, pardon you and set you free from all your sins, strengthen you in all goodness and keep you in eternal life. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. We continue in song, Angels from the Realms of Glory. us pray. Give us, O God, such love and wonder that with shepherds and pilgrims unknown we may come to adore the Holy Child, the promised King, and with our gifts worship him, our Lord and Saviour, Jesus Christ, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. We sit for the readings from the Scriptures.
The first reading is from the book of Isaiah, chapter 9, verses 2 to 7. The people who have walked in darkness have seen a great light. Those who lived in a land of deep darkness, on them light has shined. You have multiplied the nation. You have increased its joy. They rejoice before you as with joy at the harvest, as people exult when dividing plunder. For the yoke of their burden and the bar across their shoulders, the rod of their oppressor, you have broken as on the day of Midian. For all the boots of the tramping warriors and all the garments rolled in blood shall be burned as fuel for the fire. For a child has been born for us, a son given to us. Authority rests upon his shoulders, and he is named Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. His authority shall grow continually, and there shall be endless peace for the throne of David and his kingdom. He will establish and uphold it with justice and with righteousness from this time onwards and forevermore. The zeal of the Lord of hosts will do this. Hear the word of the Lord.
Please join in singing the refrain for the psalm. Today is born a Saviour, Christ the Lord.
The second reading is taken from the letter to Titus, chapter 2, reading from the 11th verse. For the grace of God has appeared, bringing salvation to all, training us to renounce impiety and worldly passions, and in the present age to live lives that are self-controlled, upright, and godly, while we wait for the blessed hope and the manifestation of the glory of our great God and Saviour, Jesus Christ. He it is who gave himself for us, that he might redeem us from all iniquity and purify for himself a people of his own who are zealous for good deeds. Hear then the word of the Lord.
We stand to join in Away in a Manger. The Lord be with you.
The Holy Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to St. Luke, chapter 2, beginning at the first verse. Glory to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
In those days a decree went out from Emperor Augustus that all the world should be registered. This was the first registration and was the governor of Syria. All went to their own towns to be registered. Joseph also went from the town of Nazareth in Galilee to Judea, to the city of David called Bethlehem, because he was descended from the house and family of David. He went to be registered with Mary, to whom he was engaged and who was expecting a child. While they were there, the time came for her to deliver her child, and she gave birth to her firstborn son and wrapped him in bands of cloth and laid him in a manger, because there was no place for them in the inn. In that region there were shepherds living in the fields, keeping watch over their flock by night. Then an angel of the Lord stood before them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them, and they were terrified. But the angel said to them, "Do not be afraid, for see, I am bringing you good news of great joy for all the people. To you is born this day in the city of David a Savior, who is the Messiah, the Lord. This will be the sign for you. You will find a child wrapped in bands of cloth and lying in a manger." And suddenly there was with the angel a multitude of the heavenly host, praising God and saying, "Glory to God in the highest heaven, and on earth peace among those whom he favors." Hear the gospel of the Lord. Praise to you.
Please be seated.
In the name of God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. "I'm sorry, miss, but I can't come to the meeting on Friday night. That's when the Beatles are on TV." In the October 1964 edition of the Church Chronicle, what used to be our diocesan magazine, an article appeared which opened with those words. The meeting was for the Girls' Friendly Society. I found that when I was looking through some old records, and it leapt out to me from the page. What struck me was not only the interesting excuse for not being able to attend the meeting, but the leader's response. If the leader of that GFS group had held the same view as was held by the writer of one of the letters to the editor just a few months before in the same publication, things could have gone seriously badly. That particular letter was highly critical of the Beatles and their influence on young people, declaring with absolute certainty that they were a passing fad and would quickly be forgotten. The writer went on to say that, in their view, what resonated with the young people of that day in the Beatles was their mediocrity, which mirrored the mediocrity and the lack of substance in those young people themselves. Ouch. The GFS leader took a completely different tack and approach, though. She decided that if all of the girls in her group wanted to watch the Beatles, that's what they do. And she made that their meeting. So they gathered together in one of the few homes that had one of those newfangled TVs. And before the broadcast, they talked together about what it was that made the Beatles so interesting. The immediate answer from the girls was that the Beatles and their music encouraged them to be different. The leader looked around the group of girls, all dressed identically, all with their hair bobbed in exactly the same way, and so pushed them a little bit further about what that meant. What emerged was that the greatest attraction being heard with honesty was that the greatest attraction in the Beatles was being heard with honesty and respected for all they were without being forced to conform to a particular mold. That was the mold that their parents wanted them to conform to. In the end, the call from the girls there to adults was, "Love us. Whatever we're like, whatever we've done, love us. Listen to us. be honest with us. I find that story even more fascinating because the people of that generation, those girls who were there in the GFS group, who were inspired so much by the Beatles, is the generation now mostly represented in our churches. 1964, add the years, and look around most church congregations other than at times like today. What struck me even more is that it seemed to me that that Friday evening was Christmas. The date wasn't the 25th of December, but what I mean is that that GFS meeting was an expression of the incarnation, God coming among us. What is at the heart of the message of Christmas? Is it that Jesus is born as a baby, but when he grows up, he'll tell everyone what to do and they'd better obey, or else? There are some places, sadly, where that seems to be the message that is shared. At the heart of this celebration, though, is something very different, which resonates with what those teenagers in the 1960s recognized would make all the difference for them. To be loved, to be listened to be treated with honesty and respect. To do those things, you actually have to be present. You have to be in a relationship to do those things. Despite the observation that teenagers are a bit scatty, although if we read in history, people have been making that observation for literally thousands of years. Read back in some of the things that Romans said about teenagers of their day. There is an observation that's been made that teenagers are a bit off track. But people who make that observation often have stopped listening and stopped being fully present to young people. People who are open, as most young people really are, know that they don't know everything. They just don't like being treated as if they know nothing by those who operate with very fixed patterns of understanding. Christmas is an invitation into relationship, into conversation, into sharing, into the sort of vulnerability where honesty permeates being together. God comes among us to be loved, to be listened to be treated with honesty and respect, yes, and also to love, to listen, to treat us with honesty and respect. That sort of vulnerability which we find in Jesus was shocking and confronting to the leaders of Jesus' day who were very fixed in their positions. Imposed black and white rules seemed to be easier to grasp and to enforce. Now that GFS leader could have said, nope, our meeting is on Friday night, you will all be there, or you might as well leave the group, or you know, your presence in the group will be tarnished if you go off and watch the Beatles instead of coming to do what I've prepared for you. Instead, what happened was far more incarnational, more grounded, more Christ-like, more real. Here we are this evening in this large, beautiful church building all together. Why? I hope not out of any feeling of compulsion or to follow a rule or direction about what has to be done. Instead, I hope that for all of you, being here is an expression of wonder. I hope that what brings all of us here is the wonder that God comes among us and loves and listens to and respects and knows us, even with all of our grittiness and the mess that we so often make of our lives, and loves us as we are, inviting us into relationship. And the invitation is also then to let the way that we are treated by God be a pattern for how we treat all of those around us, everyone around us. To treat each person with love and respect and honesty and care. To listen deeply. To share, which both means having something to offer and recognizing that everyone around us has something to be able to offer us. Living into those sorts of relationships is to live Christmas. So will this approach to Christmas be alive in every gathering and conversation you share during this next 24 hours? Will love and honesty and respect and deep listening be offered to each and every person, from the oldest to the youngest? In most places that might happen fairly easily, tends to happen relatively easily on Christmas Day. But what about the next day? And the next day? And throughout the next year? And when those relationships get strained and stretched by the messiness and the mistakes that we all make in life, then there is a rippling transformation which comes through the invitation to embrace forgiveness, which is at the heart of the message of Easter. But we'll get to that in a few months' time. And over and over and over again, until both of those invitations become so much a part of who we are that light shines in us and through us. In all of this, loving, listening, respecting, cherishing, honest relationship, God is with us. Christ is born in us today. Amen. We join with Christians throughout the world in affirming our faith in God. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose from the dead. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. From there he will come to judge both the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Let us pray for all people and for the Church throughout the world.
The response this evening is, Lord, let your light shine and let your love be born in us. Jesus, whose mother was Mary, we give thanks for those who have been mothers and fathers to us, and for your own coming into this world. We hold in prayer before you all families of every size and description, but especially those whose family life is broken in some way. Through abuse, bereavement, estrangement, debt, depression or distance. Jesus, as Joseph and Mary were bound to each other in love for you, draw each of us to those whom you have proposed us to love, that we might do so with patience and perseverance, insight and inspiration. Lord, let your light shine and let your love be born in us.
Jesus, cradled in a manger, we give thanks for those places we regard as safe, warming, and welcoming, acknowledging the blessing of the security we experience. We hold in a prayer before you all those who are homeless and living in rough on the streets, prey to violence, disease, and in some cases, their own addictions, and all those refugees in living a long way from home. In an effort to find a measure of safety and provide food and shelter for their children, Jesus, as Mary gently cradled you in holding, hold in your loving care each desperate individual and struggling family, that with family and with Mary and Joseph, they might know your presence and one day come to proclaim your glory. Lord, let your light shine and let your love.
Jesus, sharing the stable with the animals, we give thanks for the wonders of your creation which you came into so that we might know your light and life. We hold in prayer before you those things you have done to our world, which have damaged it to breaking point. Our greed to possess the best of everything, and our obsession with draining away the gifts and wonders of what we call the natural world. Jesus, as the animals brought warmth to your first hours on earth, give us the humility to set greed aside and the strength of will to use wisely the resources you provide. Lord, let your light shine and let your love be born in us.
Jesus, worshipped by the shepherds and kings, we give thanks for the diversity of cultures, nations, and races which are together, what makes us in the likeness of God. We hold in prayer before you those disputed regions of the world, where diversity of opinion or politics forms a barrier to peaceful coexistence, and where borders and barriers seek to hide brutal injustice, terror, and torture. Jesus, just as you were brought gifts, help us to use wisely those gifts of forgiveness and reconciliation, which you have given us for all the good of all nations. Lord, let your light shine and let your love be born in us.
Jesus, our Emmanuel, we give thanks that you came not only in the form of a human baby, but continue to dwell with us through the power of your Holy Spirit. We hold in prayer before you those in particular need of the knowledge of your presence with them, that through your Spirit they might know your strength, your healing, your peace, and your amazing love for them. We pray for those whom we know and those whose cries are heard by God alone. Jesus, just as you come to us daily, may we consciously make time to come to you, not just this Christmas day, but every day of our lives. Lord, let your light shine and let your love be born in us.
Jesus, we give thanks to you, our living God, born of the blessed Virgin Mary, revealed in glory, worshipped by the angels, proclaimed among the nations, believed in throughout the world, exhaled to the highest heavens. Lord, let your light shine and let your light not.
Almighty God, you have promised to hear our prayers. Grant that what we have asked in faith, we may be by your grace received. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
We pray together in the words which Jesus taught his friends. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial, and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. Please stand for the greeting of peace. We are the body of Christ.
His Spirit is in us.
The love of God is born among us. The hope of God fills our hearts. The peace of the Lord be always with you.
you join in our next carol, while this carol is being sung, there is a collection which is taken up for the work of the church here, while shepherds watch their flocks by night.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
All glory and honor be yours always and everywhere, mighty Creator, ever-living God. We give you thanks and praise for your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, who by the power of your Spirit was born of Mary and lived as one of us. In your word made flesh, you have caused a new light to shine in our hearts, to give knowledge of your glory in the face of Jesus Christ. By his death on the cross and rising to new life, he offered the one true sacrifice for sin and obtained an eternal deliverance for all his people. Therefore, with angels and archangels and with all the company of heaven, we proclaim your great and glorious name, forever praising you and singing.
Merciful God, we thank you for these gifts of your creation, this bread and wine. And we pray that by your word and Holy Spirit, we who eat and drink them may be partakers of Christ's body and blood. On the night he was betrayed, Jesus took bread, and when he had given you thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take, eat, this is my body, given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." After supper, he took the cup, and again giving you thanks, he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Drink from this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it, in remembrance of me." Therefore we do as our Saviour has commanded, proclaiming his offering of himself made once for all upon the cross, his mighty resurrection and glorious ascension, and looking for his coming again, we celebrate with this bread and this cup his one perfect and sufficient sacrifice for the sins of the whole world. Renew us by your Holy Spirit, unite us in the body of your Son, and bring us with all your people into the joy of your eternal kingdom, through Jesus Christ our Lord, with whom and in whom in the fellowship of the Holy Spirit we worship you, Father, in songs of never-ending praise. As this broken bread was once many grains, which have been gathered together and made one bread, so may your church be gathered from the ends of the earth into your kingdom. The gifts of God for the people of God. Come, let us take this holy sacrament of the body and blood of Christ in remembrance that he died for us, and feed on him in our hearts by faith with thanksgiving. All those who would usually receive communion in other places are welcome to receive communion here today. You may like otherwise also to come forward for a prayer of blessing.
God of heaven dwelling among us, we thank you for feeding us with this holy food. By your grace, keep us ever faithful to your word made flesh, that as his body in the world, we may bring your presence to all people. Lord, may your love be born in us. May your light shine in our hearts. And may your joy be seen in our every word and action, this day and in all the days ahead. I wish for you all a peaceful and blessed celebration of Christmas. Safe travels for those who are moving around in various ways to be with family and friends, and perhaps in some holidays afterwards. A peaceful and blessed Christmas and a celebrating new year. We've been through a few years of difficulty over the last few. It wasn't just 2020, it seems to have rolled through for several years. May 2023 be filled with more light and more peace. At each of the entrances to the church, there are some yellow sheets which have notices for the church community and include something about the services which will be happening over the next month. Here at St. Luke's, we will continue to have the 8 o'clock service on each Sunday, and there will be a service at 10 o'clock at St. Mark's, but those will be the only services in the parish for the next 4 weeks. And then our normal pattern will begin at the end of January. So take a copy of those. For anybody who may ask, may have slept already or wasn't able to get here, then we do have services here at 8 o'clock and 10 o'clock in the morning. Please stand for the blessing. Christ, the Son of God, born of Mary, fill you with his grace to trust his promises and obey his will. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, be upon you and remain with you this day and always. Amen.
Go in peace to love and serve the Lord. In the name of Christ, amen.
Our final carol, Joy to the World.